Welcome to Messiah Christian Church. We're thrilled to have you with us this morning as we worship together as a community. As you know, we've suspended the in-person services for right now, and I really want to thank you guys for being online with us. If you're joining us for the first time, we're really glad to have you with us. Go to your comment section and fill out the connect card so we can get to know you better and be able to pray for you. Right now, we'd love to have you share this broadcast, maybe with a friend who needs encouragement, share it to a group, or go to news feed, or start a watch party. Today, we are celebrating the season of Advent. The word Advent simply means coming. Each year, we light an Advent wreath as a sign that we are looking forward to the coming of Jesus Christ.
Isaiah 9, 2 through 7. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Gloria, Gloria, Gloria. chorus of joy because hope was born this night. Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Let all of the world sing the chorus of joy because hope was born this night. I know hope was born this night because Christ was born this night.
Amen. A few announcements this morning. I want to remind you, next Sunday, December 13th, we're outside and we are in a drive-in service to watch our children perform a living nativity for us. It's going to be great. It starts at 9:30. Please don't miss it. It's awesome. And don't forget to register online. You can sit in your vehicle or stay outside of your car with a chair or a blanket. Be sure you wear your face coverings that are required, especially when you're outside. Make sure your Christmas Eve plans include our drive-in candlelight service at 4 p.m. And we're featuring a local children's choir and the annual giving tree for our children, where all the children will be receiving gifts. It's a great church service. Also, I want to remind you, for those of you who took the Christmas blessing this year, be sure to return your gifts to the church anytime between today and next Sunday at our drive-in service. We want to be sure that the kids get all the gifts to their families. At this time, I really want to let's take up our tithes and our offerings and give to the Lord. I want to remind you, God doesn't want us to waste our lives. God wants us to use our lives in a powerful way for His name and for His kingdom. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10. It's a great verse. It says, take heed on how you build your life. The key word here is take heed on how. How do we build our lives? Take heed means that we need to be intentional about how we build our lives. Be intentional about how we use our time. Be intentional about how you use your gifts and your talents for the Lord. And be intentional about how you use your finances. In a minute on your screen, a slide will come up for various ways to give. There's also a link in the Facebook comment section that links directly to our PayPal account. But before we do anything, let's pray. Let's ask God's blessing that at this time that the word of God would go forth, people would hear the good news of Jesus Christ, and He would use our giving. So let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the gift of life. We thank You, Lord, that You're very clear. You want us to use our lives, our finances, God, for You and for Your kingdom. Receive our tithe, receive our offerings, God. May they make an eternal difference in many, many people's lives. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen.
You see.
shivers in the cold, let us bring him silver and gold. Let us bring him silver and gold.
Let's open up our Bibles this morning. We're examining Ephesians chapter 3, verses 16 through 20. This is one of the most richest and most significant passages in the Word of God. And the reason is because it really clearly directs our lives and reveals to us really how God transforms our lives. These passages help us to do what we've been talking about last week, where we understand that we are a rich, rich people, that God has tremendous inheritance for us. His wisdom, his knowledge, his power, his patience. And on the other side, we are trying to live life and we're trying to honor God. And so we've been talking about the ignition switch, which really is in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 16 through 20. These past 2 weeks, I've talked with you about the first three steps of the five sequential steps that are important in turning on this switch. The first one, as you remember, was we are to be strengthened in our inner man by the power of the Holy Spirit. The second one was that we know that Christ indwells our life. And third, we talked about being rooted and grounded in the love of Christ and then actually living a love life. Those three alone are very, very powerful. But today I want to continue talking about Christ's love, and I also want to add step number four, step number five, which are amazing. Open up and let's look at Ephesians chapter 3, verse 19. It says that we would know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. Now, I want you to notice here, this is not the love for Christ. This is the love of Christ. It's the very same love that Christ had. Totally amazing. We can literally love with the love of Jesus Christ. Actually, Christ wants us to love with his love. Christ wants us to love people the very same way that he loved them. He loved them sacrificially. He loved them selflessly. He loved them by giving and sharing and offering himself up on behalf of who they are and their needs. This is exactly how Christ wants us to live too. But this only comes when we're controlled by the Holy Spirit. It's the love of Christ. And listen, the love of Christ, it says in this passage, surpasses knowledge. What a wonderful thought. There's no way human beings can ever know this type of love without being connected and being a part of who Jesus Christ is. The world does not have this kind of love. It surpasses knowledge. We have a love of Christ that surpasses all knowledge. We are different. Thank you, Lord. And so Paul says here, look first, if you have the inner strength of the Holy Spirit, and then you move to the indwelling Christ who is at home in you, then you have the love of Christ that surpasses all knowledge. Wow. This is for every situation in all of our lives. God wants us to experience this. He wants us to understand that the world will never know, but God's people will. I mean it. We ought to be able to knock the world right off of its feet with the love of Jesus Christ. I believe that's what Christ wants us to do. How we are to live with his love, not our own love, his love. What is this love like? Well, verse 18. Look there. It says that we might know what is the breadth, what is the length, what is the depth, and what is the height of Christ's love. The love of Christ extends in all directions. And he says the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height is illustrated by the cross of Jesus Christ. The cross is the greatest symbol of the love of Christ. If you look at the cross, you'll see the upper arm. And that upper arm points up. And then you have this bottom arm, which points down. And then you have the cross arms. One arm goes around to the east. The other goes around to the west. Wow. It extends to the whole wide world. God's love is big enough for you, for me, and for everybody else that we know in this whole wide world. His love is universal. Its breadth, it can reach literally anybody. Its length, it runs from eternity past to eternity future. Its depth, I love. It reaches to the pit of sin. Its height, wow. It takes us into the very presence of God and sits us on the throne of God. This is the love of Christ. This is the type of love that we are to build our lives on. Christ's love is a kind of love that we are to comprehend and seize it every day, every moment, every person that we're with. The love of Christ is the kind of love that reaches two parties that even hate each other. It's the kind of love that runs from one part of our lives to the very end of our lives. The love of Christ is the kind of love that reaches to the person who is in deep, deep sin. The love of Christ is the kind of love that lifts up a person to the very presence of God. Wow. This is what Christ is talking about. This is the type of love that we need to know. And with that, we can share with other people. And so Paul says that we have a deep experiential knowledge of Christ's love. We have a comprehension of its fullness, an expression of that same fullness that can only happen because we are rooted and we are grounded in the love of Jesus Christ. Because Christ is at home inside of us. Because we are strong in the inner man because of the Spirit of God. This is living life at full throttle. And this is how you and I are to be living. The Word of God is very, very clear. It is awesome. This leads to our fourth truth, and that is in verse 19. And it says in verse 19 that in order that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. And that's what I want to talk with you about today. And that is the fullness of God. It follows the sequence. We can be filled with all the fullness of God. I want you to think about it. All of the fullness of God. You know, as I was reading this passage, I was thinking it's one thing for me to think about being filled with the Holy Spirit in verse 16. That's amazing by itself. It's another thing for me to think about being filled with Christ in verse 17. That is awesome. But now, to be filled with God? God doesn't settle for anything less than total fullness of the entire Trinity. I want you to think about this. And now God says he wants you and I to be filled with him, the eternal God, the almighty God, the creator God, the sustainer God, the God who made the whole wide world, the God who fills it, and now wants to fill me, wants to fill you. It's incredible. Let's face it. There's no way to measure it. I don't know how to measure it. That somehow God, who fills it all, can now fill me. He can come and live inside of me. And he would all be there. It's not just a piece of God. He doesn't say that. It is God in his fullness that lives in you and in me. I don't know about you, but that is incredible. That thought, that reality is awesome. The reality that the fullness of God lives in me is awesome. I want us this morning to set your mind on this. God never intends Christians to function half full. Never. God's word tells us we are to be full, 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 and full. Paul says this over and over and over again. Verse 19 is clear, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. And then in Ephesians 1:23, he says the body, the church, is the fullness of him that fills all in all. I don't know about you, but that is totally amazing. Wow. I want to illustrate this to you. The word here for full, the Greek is plero, and it's actually is used many, many times in the Bible, especially in the New Testament, that speaks of total fullness. God is dominant in us. God is in his fullness, has total dominance of my life, of your life. But let's face it, this is how I think some of us think. Over here, we have a picture of you and I, and what we know is that inside of us, we have God, we have the fullness of Jesus, we have the fullness of the Holy Spirit. The scriptures are clear. But yet in our mind, we can go and daily say, well, I'll take Jesus, I'll take a little bit of Jesus, I'll take a little bit of Jesus' patience, but I'll keep a little my own bitterness and anger and resentment. Or we say, well, we know the Holy Spirit lives in us, so I'll take a little bit of the Holy Spirit, right? But I also will say, but I want to hold on to my own power too. I'll have a little bit of the Spirit of God and a little bit of my power. Or we can look and say, oh, God lives in me. I'll take a little bit of God, right? But I also will take a little bit of control. I still want to be in partial control of my life. Wow, many, many people live this way. They function this way. But in the end, what happens is we have a little bit of God, right? And we have a whole lot of ourself. This is not how we are to live. Biblically, this is very clear. And I want to challenge you guys who are listening today. Maybe you live that way. You take a little bit of God, little bit of Jesus, little bit of the Holy Spirit, and then you take a lot of yourself. It's not the way God tells us to live at all. At all. The truth is, when we're filled with the Holy Spirit, self is actually out of the picture. We are totally dominated and wrapped up in the Trinity. God doesn't want to share us with us. Let me say it again. God doesn't want to share us with us. It isn't a little bit of God and a little bit of me, a little bit of Jesus and a little bit of me. No, actually, it is the opposite of that. The Bible speaks of it as the fullness of God. It would be like this if I had a blanket and I took this blanket and I wrapped myself in this blanket. What would I do? I would be dominated by this blanket. I would be wrapped up in this blanket. And that is what the scriptures are talking about. We are full of the Holy Spirit. We are full of God. We are full of Jesus in our lives. I want you to get a picture of that, because that is the way God wants us to live. Truly amazing, I know. Truly, truly amazing. And he wants us to live that way every day, all the time, in every situation, with any people we deal with. Wow. What an awesome thought about a way to live. Imagine if you turned on that switch and said, I submit to that work. Go ahead, God, do that in me. Imagine what life would be like. Amazing, amazing, amazing. I want to illustrate this point with a story. And I want to tell you this story. I was driving home from church after a meeting with a group of guys on discipleship, great group of guys, and after I was done, I was totally beat. It was a Tuesday night, and it was a long day for me, and truth be told, I really just wanted to go home. I just wanted to have supper with Rosemary, and I just wanted to get some rest. Well, I was making my way down from the church, and I went by Fletcher Street, right over by the high school, and I saw and I heard an ambulance. I pulled over to the side of the road, and it passed me. It passed me going really, really fast, and it was a cold night. It was an icy night. I watched as its bright red taillights sped ahead of me, moving towards North 35. It was freezing outside, and I was so glad I was headed home. In my heart, I said, Lord, that poor person having to be carried out, maybe on a gurney, on this kind of a night. I was like, Lord, help them. And I prayed. It was awesome. And then I pulled back onto the road, and I heard a voice say, follow that ambulance. Well, I just told you that we are to live in the fullness of God, right? We are to let the Holy Spirit, God the Father, and Jesus take control of our every part of our life. I told you that. That is his plan for our lives. But I'm a person who likes order, and I like a schedule. It was not on my schedule to follow that ambulance. Who knows where? I'm going home, and that's what I had in mind to do. So I pushed the voice aside. I was full of me. I was functioning like I told you not to function. A little bit of God and a little bit of me that day. Well, I watched that ambulance, and it was getting out of view, and I heard that same voice again, follow that ambulance. I thought, it's cold. I have no idea where it's going. Where's it going to go? Who's it going to? This could be embarrassing. This could be very unwelcoming. And besides, my wife Rosemary is waiting home for me. And And just as the ambulance faded out of view, I heard it again. Follow that ambulance. Wow. You see, God wants literally himself to fill us. What kind of God do we have who wants to fill us? If you have your Bibles, open up to 2 Samuel chapter 22, verses 2 and 3. David speaks of his God and sings a word of praise. And I want you to listen to how David describes God. David says, "The Lord is my rock. The Lord is my fortress. The Lord is my deliverer. The God of my rock, in him will I trust. God is my shield. God is the horn of my salvation. God is my high tower, my refuge, my savior. You, Lord, save me from violence. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from mine enemies." Wow. Can you imagine that? What a God. What a God we have. And these passages just give us a glimpse of who he is. It is the God who wants to fill you. The God who wants to fill me. And this is the God that wants to enable us. The God that wants to empower us. The God who wants to do all good pleasure of his will through you and through me. Again, inner strength by the Spirit of God leads to the dwelling of Christ in us, which leads to incomprehensible love, which leads to infinite fullness by the whole Trinity of God. You see, when God's love permeates us through Christ, through his Trinity, then all of this follows. It all follows that sequence. Wow. What an awesome, awesome scripture verse. What an awesome way to live. God is very specific about how he wants us to live. Here's the question. Here's the question for you. Here's the question for me. Will we let God fill us? Will you let God fill you totally with all three? Maybe someone on the other end of that ambulance needed God in me to be the rock, to be a fortress, to be a shield. Would I function with all of this love that God has put in me? In all of his fullness, would I obey him? Would I actually believe his word in Ephesians 3, 16 through 20? Would I believe it? Would you believe it? Would you actually live this way? Wow. It's a big question we all need to answer. Will you allow God to work in you to reach the world for him? What about you? Will you function this way? Will you yield your life? Will you be driven by the love of Christ? Will you let the fullness of the Trinity control, dominate, wrap you up, and lead you? Will you do that? We all know the Word of God. It's not an issue of knowing the Word. It's an issue of whether we want to yield or not. Don't ever forget that. Wow. And then this fifth point, which totally blows me away. Totally blows me away, this fifth point. And that is right there. God now is able. We now have, in this fifth step, internal power by God. When this happens, the explosion takes place. The engine is completely on. The blast is on. Look at verse 20. Wow. It comes in a great doxology, with a great ignition, with a great explosion. Let it explode in your heart today. Verse 20. Now, unto him who is able. Listen. Here's the praise. When a believer follows these five steps, when you follow this sequence, make no doubt about it. Now he is able. Just say that. Go to that fifth step and say, okay, Lord, now you are able. It's where God wants us to go. He is able. Do you realize that as powerful as God is, you hold the trigger that determines whether he's able or not in your life to accomplish all that he wants to do through you? Do you know? Do you understand? You hold the trigger. But think about it. Now that you have yielded to the Holy Spirit and he has touched your inner man and you have inner strength and now you know the power of the indwelling Christ and you have understood the love of Christ that surpasses all knowledge. Think about this. And now you are filled with the fullness of Christ and God and the Holy Spirit living in you. Think about those four steps. Wow. Now, he is able to do. Listen carefully. Exceedingly, abundantly, above all that you could ask or think or imagine. Listen. According to the power of God that works in you. According to the power of God that works in you. That is why we must submit. That is why we must obey. That is why we must understand. This power works in you, works in me. In verses 16 through 19. So that we would be full of God, full of his love. And then, when we're dominated and controlled by that, he is able. How many of you today are saying, well, I don't think it's going to work. I'm not so sure he's able. I can't do it. You're right, you can't. But verse 20 says, he is able to do all that you ask or think or imagine. He is able to do above all of that. Think of it. He's able to do exceedingly abundantly. You're wondering if it's going to work. God says it's he who works abundantly. Above all that you could ask. And why? That's the question. It's so easy to read verse 20 and forget verses 16 through 19. Don't do that. Go back. Study 16, 17, 18, 19. Then grasp verse 20. Why? Because you and I are to yield to the indwelling. Yield to the love that we're rooted and grounded in that. Yield to the fullness of Christ and the Spirit of God and God the Father himself. And then God will do exceedingly more than you or I could ever ask or even imagine. Please don't ever put limits on God. Don't do that. Don't ever say, Lord, I don't know if you can use me in this situation. Let me be clear. He can. Submit to verses 16, 17, 18, 19. Let him do the work. He can and he wants to use you beyond your dreams, beyond your imaginations. Make no doubt about it. The power is there. The resources are there for sure. There's no limit to what God can do. You would all agree. I love Isaiah 40, verse 31. God said to the prophet Isaiah, "You will mount up with wings as eagle. He will cause you to run and not be weary. He will cause you to walk and not faint." God can accomplish things through us that you and I have never dreamed of. I pray that in your heart, you would dream them. But we must follow God's pattern. We must yield to the power of the Spirit. We must let the Holy Spirit strengthen us in the inner man. We must let Christ indwell us and be at home in us. We must yield to the fullness of God, of Jesus, and the Spirit. And then, power of God will flow in you and through you, and you'll change the world for Jesus Christ. It's how he wants us to live. Let me go back to my story. So here I am, 9 o'clock at night. I'm following the ambulance to who knows where, to who knows what. I'm driving there, but I'm battling with my flesh against God. Many of you know that. Many of you know that in your own life. The God who is able and wants to flow through you to do something exceedingly, abundantly, above all that you could even think or even ask. But on the flesh side, I'm hearing, "I want to go home. I just want to be warm. I don't want to go follow that ambulance and someone think I'm crazy. I don't want to do any of that." Right? It's how the flesh works. Doesn't want you to live for God. Wants you to live for yourself. But we know different, right? We know we are to live for the Lord and not for ourselves. But if I follow these five steps, I'd be hearing God say, "Listen, obey me. Go. Do it now. I have a plan for you. I put you on earth for my purpose. I will show you what to do when you get there." The person on the other side is praying right now. They're asking me to do something exceedingly, abundantly, beyond all that they could ask or even imagine. I, God, living in you, want to send you. You go on my behalf. Wow. I want you to pour out my love on them. I want my fullness in me and trust that I am able. Wow. Can you hear God say that to you? Some of you might have situations now, and maybe you don't want to hear that. Listen to the Lord. The Lord wants to use you, not in your own strength or power, but in his. So now I'm fully engaged. I'm chasing this ambulance, and I must have looked like a volunteer firefighter without a red light and a blue light on my dashboard. And I noticed that the ambulance is stopping at a house just up a little ways. And I look and I think, I know that house. I then pull into the driveway, and I'm following the EMTs and the police, and they're getting all their gear out of their trucks and their cars, and I look up, and there it is. It's the house of a good friend of mine, precious friend of mine. I jumped out of my car, followed the EMTs and the police into the house. And now I'm thinking, I know I should be here. I am fully ignited as a result of submitting to these five steps. And I know that my friend is praying for God to show up, and he needs me. But there's a problem. The EMT and the police weren't so sure of that. The EMT looked at me horrified and asked me, "Who are you? What are you doing here right now?" I looked at them and said, "Well, I'm a pastor in a local church, and I'm a fire chaplain." Now, I want you to realize the last thing that they need is some nosy bystander in the midst of a man having apparent heart attack. They don't want that. And so I still wasn't sure what was going to happen next. But at that moment, right after he had asked me that, my friend heard my voice, and he yelled out of his chair, "Pastor Dan! Pastor Dan, it is so good that you're here with me." Can you imagine? So I walked right over to him. He's an older gentleman, and he was holding his heart. I thought he was having a heart attack. He looked afraid. I went over to him, and I simply placed my hand on him, and I prayed, "Lord, help him right now be at peace and to know that you are with him, you are for him, and you are able, God, to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that he asks or can even think." And then I ended the prayer. And I said to my friend, I said, "You are going to be fine. The Lord is with you. He is going to take care of you. He loves you unconditionally." Did all of that in about 30 seconds. Then I backed out, and I let the EMTs do their thing. Wow. That is the way God wants you and me to live. Not once in a while. Not a little God, little Jesus, little Spirit, but wrapped up in, fully dominated by, controlled by Father God, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. I've come to the conclusion I'll never be content until I begin to see in our lives abundant, beyond what God wants to do in myself and in you. How about you? What I've seen God do in the past, I know he will do again. He is a faithful, faithful God. His word will stand in the heavens forever and ever. He will never change his word. And I want him to see it in your life individually and also collectively as a church. I want you to look at Ephesians 3:21, because not only is he able, but I want you to understand why. Verse 21 closes with this powerful, powerful reality. Unto him be the glory. Unto him be the glory in the church by Jesus Christ throughout all and all ages. Generations without end. Wow. Amen. But we have to understand, people, God can't be glorified in the church until the church uses its power and its resources. Why? Understand. You and I are a living advertisement for God. If God is to be glorified in the church, it is to be because the church is moving in an expression of the mighty power that he has. And so, let God translate this into your living and how you're living today and what situations you're involved in today and what your prayer life is like and what God wants to do in you. Translate it in a practical way, not in some philosophy that is empty, but in a reality that the Word of God impacts your life, changes your life, transforms your life. Wow. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be cheated. Listen, don't cheat yourself out of what God can do. Don't you be thinking, oh, I only have a little power. I only have a little resource. No, that's a lie. That's a lie because of Ephesians 3:19. And don't be going around thinking, oh, I can't make a difference in anybody's life. That is a lie too. You can. Follow Ephesians 3:16, 17, 18, 19. And let God get the glory for your life. And don't be satisfied till that happens. Not just in you, but everyone around you. It's how God wants us to live. It is very, very clear. We don't have to question this. It is the truth from the throne of God. Submit to it. Yield to it. And let God use you in a way that would honor and bring glory to him. Because one day, we're going to face him face to face. In closing this morning, the key on every one of these five steps is surrender. Surrender to the work of the Spirit of God internally in you, to do a deep work in you, not superficial, but deep, that the indwelling Christ would take over your life, that you would know the depth of his love. A love that comes from Jesus Christ himself, imparted to you because of the cross, changes your life, my life, because he wants us to live that way. Submit to that. Wow. This morning we're going to close by singing a song. And as we do, I want you to submit. Right where you're at, in your own home, just say, Lord, I heard your word today, and I want that for me. I want to live that way, God. Let God put a desire in you to really make a difference for him and not live according to this world or by what you think or how you should live, but according to his word that stands in the heaven forever and ever. Surrender to it.
You are famous for, what you are famous for, shut the mouth.
inside of me. Unleash your power for all to see. Spirit, come and fall on us over and over. Oh Lord, make way through the water. Walk me through the fire. Do what you are famous for. What you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions. Bring dry bones to life. And do what you are famous for. What you are famous for. God of exceedingly, God of abundantly, more than we ask or think, Lord, you will be.
Beautiful song. And I really want to encourage you, if you're listening today and you sense God in you is speaking to you, I want to affirm He is. He is trying to get your attention. He's trying to speak life and hope into you. Keep your heart open, receive it, and do what He tells you to do. In closing, I want to remind you about the Christmas blessing gifts. Just get them back to the church by next Sunday. Drop them off at the church all during the week. Don't forget to attach the tag to the outside of the gift. Really want to encourage you. Next week, our children are going to be doing the Living Nativity. It's a great service. I'd love for you all to come, be together, remember Jesus Christ and His birth coming to this earth. Celebrate with us together. Drive here. Worship together. Please come next week. If you're online and you would like to be connected in our church family, we'd love to have you. Fill out that comment card that's pinned on the Facebook page. Contact our church. We'd love to have you. You're always welcome. Join us back next Sunday, 9:30, and don't forget our 8 o'clock sunglasses every night. Share this broadcast. Maybe it's helping you. Maybe there's someone you know that's not doing well, isolated, alone, by themselves. Share the good news with them that they would understand the very fullness of God in their lives too. Have a great day. Be blessed. Thank you for being with us here. I love you and I appreciate you. Have a great day.